Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and our dear viewers. We are here with you on the World Mental Health Day and getting to you, opening the lock to the keys of your mental health is Dr. Ali Khwaja. He is the chairman and founder of Banjara Academy, IITN, and has done his PhD in behavioral sciences. So who else can be a much better person to be talking to us about the world, about health, mental health? So over to Dr. Ali.
Very good morning to everybody. How is your mental health today? Imagine if you go and ask a friend of yours that question, what sort of answer do you think you will get? On the other hand, if a friend of yours is looking a little tired or pulled down or whatever it is, and if you ask how is your health, meaning to say physical health, that person will actually feel nice. Oh, thank you for inquiring, you know, I'm just recovering from fever, or no, I didn't sleep last night and that's the reason why I'm feeling very tired. So nice of you to inquire and stuff like that, right? When you inquire about physical health, people feel nice. Very often, even if you don't inquire, people start talking about it. I don't know, last few days I've been having this stomach problem. I should do something about it. I think maybe I've been eating out too, or some such thing. Very comfortably, they will say, even if it's a serious ailment. I've been referred to the oncologist, you know, they are suspecting some form of cancer. So I was very worried. I thought I'll talk to you about it. I hope it turns out to be something very minor and I can get over it. Anything like that. In the physical realm, people are more than willing to, you know, talk about, discuss, reach out to others, share experiences, or, you know, share what knowledge they have and therapies and whatever it is. But when it comes to mental health, People don't even want to talk about it. The reason, the answer for this is very, very simple. People think mental health means mental illness. Out of the 30 odd books that I've written, one of them is on mental health. In fact, I was going to write a book on mental illnesses and disorders, but I thought, no, it's too dangerous. Nobody will come near that book. So I just titled it as Mental Health. And believe me, that is the least selling of all my books. People don't even want to open it and see, as though by opening the page of that mental health book, you know, you'll go mad or some mental ailment will hit you and things like that. Somewhere along the line, we seem to think that there are only two categories of human beings in this world. Those mentally ill people, whom we refer to as insane, lunatics, those type of derogatory words we use, no? There are that category of people. You'll see some of them, poor chaps, standing on the road, looking at the sky, talking to themselves. You'll see somebody with torn clothes and mumbling, you know, not even aware of what's happening around and things of that sort. So we say these are these lunatics, these are these mentally ill, insane type of people, and we keep as far away as from them as possible. And we think the rest of the world, all of us, including me, we have wonderful and very good mental health. That's not true. Mental health is also a continuum, the same way as physical health. Even if today I'm not suffering from a major physical disorder, I may have, as I just mentioned, a stomach ache. I may be running slight temperature. Because I've been sitting on my chair for long hours, I may be having some neck pain or back pain or something of that sort. So nobody can say that they have perfect mental, physical health. And there's no exact dividing line between wellness and illness. Sometimes people with major illnesses also. I have a friend, for example, who was diagnosed with very serious cancer 30 years back. And after the basic treatment, she was told that please come regularly for a checkup, but because you don't know when it can recur and when things will happen and things like that. And for the last almost 30 years, she has not gone back to any doctor. And she is doing whatever else she has to do. She has brought up her children. She is doing everything fine. So would you label her, if you go and check on her medical records where she got her treatment done, they would say that this person is a cancer patient. But she doesn't seem to think so. So that's what I mean to say, that even in physical ailments, there is no dividing line that this is a sick person and this is a healthy person. In mental health, all the more so. Because mental health is such a fuzzy, such an undefined line. Let's say you have a friend who's perpetually short-tempered, always shouting at people for no rhyme or reason. Slightest provocation and he just loses his stop. How would you define him? Would you say he's a short-tempered person, or would you say he's got a mental disorder or whatever it is? Yes, he does. He actually has a mental disorder. It's a personality disorder. He cannot control his temperature, the anger and temper and things like that. But if anybody were to dare to tell him that, see, your mental health seems to be bad because of the way you're losing your temper every now and then, why don't we do something about it? Probably he'll shout loudest at you and say that, get lost, you are the one who's mad. I'm not mad, I've got nothing to eat. But then see, you've been shouting. Yes, of course I'm shouting. When these people do bad things, why should I keep quiet? I have to set them right, and the only way to set them right is to discipline them and to scold them and things like that sort. I know what I'm doing. But then he's losing out on relationships, he may lose out on his job, his family may be extremely upset with him. Quality of life can go down so badly with such people, and yet they deny that they have got any mental health issues. And that is why today, on this occasion of the Mental Health Day, I thought, you know, after a week-long short videos, which we kept putting up at 11 o'clock every day for the last 1 week, just as a backgrounder to understand what is mental health. Mental health is not absence of mental illness. mental health is a lot of other factors. Okay, let us start from well-being. When we want to have well-being, when we want to be in solace and in peace and in harmony and things of that sort, we need to have good physical health, of course. If I'm having aches and pains or if I'm suffering from some debilitating illness, I can't say that I am in well-being. So that is one. Equally important, sometimes I feel more important, is your mental health. Even if you have a not so functional body, but your mind is good, you can still lead a good quality of life. I had and have friends who are quadriplegics, paralyzed neck down. Their entire body is dysfunctional. And yet they lead a good quality of life because their brain is fully functional. They can think, they can emote, they can make relationships, they can discuss, they can teach, they can learn, they can enjoy, they can eat the best of food, they can do whatever they want to do. No? Contrast that with people who have a perfectly healthy body, but their mind is malfunctioning. Like I gave you the example of the person who is so short-tempered that he just does not control himself, and every day he gets into fights, either with his colleagues and bosses or with his family members or even people on the road and things of that sort. What is the quality of life? And that is why I'm saying that when we talk about well-being, physical health is not enough. It also has to be good mental health. There is a third dimension to it, spiritual health, which gives you that deeper meaning of life, that solace, that ability to handle stress without distress, to be able to think that even if things are not going well now, there is perhaps a meaning for my existence, why I've come in, and I have to fulfill my path, my journey of life, and then I will move on. So these are the three aspects. Physical health, as you know, the preventive, preservative roles are played by everybody. Even an illiterate mother knows that if her child goes out and gets wet in the rain, she has to immediately change his clothes, dry his hair, give him something hot to drink and things like that. Same thing with preservative health. When the child goes to school, give him a bottle of water so that he doesn't drink polluted water outside. Give him a tiffin with homemade food. See to it that he has a proper bath and he remains clean and all that, to preserve his physical health. Only once in a while when things go wrong, for the curative part, we go to the doctor. He's got fever, the fever is not coming down or something, so we go there. Or he's got this severe headaches and these and that, whatever. It's going beyond the preservative and preventive role. Then we go to the doctor and then the doctor treats you and things like that. The other end of it, spiritual well-being. So many people have very wise and very knowledgeable gurus who tell you that this is the way you have to tackle life. This is the way you have to handle adversity. This is the way where you have to look at the broader picture of your existence and things of that sort. And they also provide solace and calmness and harmony and all those things. So, okay, the spiritual health remains good. In between is this funny thing called mental health. It starts with the stigma itself. I can't even tell anybody that I'm feeling depressed or I'm feeling angry every time or I'm feeling this or that. Similarly, people are not supposed to ask, how is your mental health? Even asking that question itself can be such a put off. The other person may say, why are you asking such a question? Do I look mad to you or something of that sort? So we can't even inquire. That is the stigma to mental health, which we want to get over. And for that, we have been constantly working on it for the last almost 40 years now, trying to promote in our own little way how people's mental health can be made better, how people's mental health can be kept in a good condition. Okay, now how do you measure whether I have good mental health or not? Sometimes, as I told you, there are some very obvious symptoms. I gave the example of a person who just cannot control his temper. There could be somebody who is very obviously depressed, so depressed that he becomes dysfunctional, he doesn't want to talk to anybody, he does not do his routine work and things of that sort. So these are, of course, certain indicators. But even then, when do you say that the anger has taken on a situation where this person needs external help or curative therapy? When do you say that the depression is so bad that we can label it as clinical depression and this person has to go for therapy or to a mental health professional or medication or whatever it is? There is no dividing line. In mental health, there are no diagnostic tools. There is no thermometer. There is no blood pressure apparatus. There is no checking like in blood sugar and anything of that sort. So all this has to be done by human intellect. When you go to, for example, to a psychiatrist, as I said, the psychiatrist has no diagnostic tools. He can't write out a chit to the pathological lab and say, get a blood test done, urine test done, get an x-ray, get an MRI, and that based on that I'll tell you what's wrong with you. No, nothing of that sort. So what do we do? Let me start with a very simple, you know, barometer or a way of checking whether your mental health is going well or not. See, 99% of children have good mental health. The only children who do not have good mental health are the ones who have been harassed very badly. Those who have gone through abuse, those who have been molested, those who have been put down very badly. Those are the children whose, along with the body, the mind can get affected and their mental health can go down. Thankfully, that percentage is not too much. In a culture like ours, where we genuinely love and care for our children, we not only do not abuse our children, we protect them from abuse from any other source. So if a child has, barring maybe one odd bad incident here and there, if the child has gone through a reasonably good, protected, and, you know, a positive upbringing, children have very good mental health. Now, as I go up into the adulthood, a small percentage, 1-1.5% of the entire population get succumbed to major mental illnesses. Those are called psychosis, where the person loses touch with reality. Schizophrenia, bipolar disorder. In later years, it could be dementia and Alzheimer's and those type of ailments. These are all psychoses where a person loses touch with reality and the person needs to be under constant care and treatment by a psychiatrist, coupled up with a clinical psychologist, etc. And he may require long-term treatment. But as I said, that is 1 or 2% of the population. 98% of us do not suffer from psychosis or major mental illness. But many of us do suffer from neurosis, where we are getting into bad habits. We are doing things which are not acceptable to society, but we are aware of it. And yet we can't come out of it. Even addiction to substances like alcohol and drug are recognized as neurotic disorders. Even though the person is aware, when he wakes up the next morning, he realizes that he had got drunk, he may have misbehaved, he's done something wrong, he feels guilty, he feels bad about it. Sometimes he goes and apologizes to some family members if he has been bad to them the previous night or something of that sort. But before you know it, the craving takes over him. And by evening, he is back to getting drunk or, you know, hit by those drugs and things of that sort. So right from there to personality disorders like being short-tempered, not being able to control your anger, so many other things we have. You must have heard of things like OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder, or ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. All these come under the category of neurosis and there is no dividing line. So as a layperson, as somebody who does not have any in-depth knowledge or training in either psychiatry or in psychology, how do you measure whether a person has, you know, gone through a bout of or is going through a bout of low mental health? In physical ailments, one of the most common things is the fever. The moment you touch and say, oh, your body seems hot, you pull out a thermometer, stick it in, and you say, yes, 99 degrees temperature. So maybe you take an off today, have lots of fruit juices, keep yourself warm, stay at home, and let's hope by tomorrow, I'll take some paracetamol, and by tomorrow day after, you should be fit and fine. But if the thermometer is showing 102, 103 degrees, and it has been so since yesterday, day before, no, I think we need to go to a doctor. If it is 105, 106, I think this patient has to be referred straight away to the hospital. Things can go very bad. So that is how I said that we use all these, starting from the thermometer to so many other diagnostic tools, to measure whether anybody's physical health is going down. In mental health, we have no diagnostic tools. So one of the simplest ones, I'm not saying that it is a complete indicator like a thermometer, but at least enough to caution you, is lowering of your sense of humor. If you see a person whose humor quotient seems to be going down, what does that mean? If somebody is talking to him lightheartedly, does he start getting impatient? Does he want to be taken very seriously? When he's talking and somebody interrupts, he blows his top. If somebody cracks a joke at his expense, he gets extremely agitated. He does not want to acknowledge and accept that, yes, life has got its ups and downs. Sometimes good things happen, sometimes bad things happen. He will not be able to acknowledge that, you know, somebody has made fun of him or something of that sort. So when a person's sense of humor starts going down, that could be a first indicator to you that this person's mental health is going down. We need to do something about it. And like I told you in the case of temperature, depending on how much it is going down, how bad it is, how dysfunctional this person is getting, since how many days this has been happening, we need to start taking care of that. But much before that, we also need to understand that there are preservative and preventive roles in mental health. Curative comes much later, if and when a person succumbs to some form of disorder, which again, as I told you, is a small percentage. The large majority of us go through some transient situational disturbances. Some of us bounce back naturally. Some of us bounce back with the help of our loved ones, our near and dear. They give us sort of support and they are optimistic and they say, don't worry, we are all there with you. We'll somehow tackle whatever is happening and overcome that thing. If we do not do that, then we may start going deeper and deeper. Like if I ignore my fever, it may eventually turn out to be malaria or dengue or H1N1 or even COVID or whatever it is, right? So the preventive part of it, the preservative part of it, all of us can do. Be among positive people, a simple thing. Like how in physical listening we say that, you know, be with the people who are healthy or who are maintaining good sense of hygiene so that you don't acquire any, you know, transmittable diseases through them. The same thing happens here. Be in the company of positive people. As far as possible, avoid negative people, people who backbite, people who are short-tempered, people who create that unpleasantness all around you. If you can get away from them, nothing like it. Supposing you can't get away from them, then what do you do? If they are very close to you, learn to insulate yourself mentally. Even that can be done. There are ways and means of doing it. I'm not going into the details now. But as long as I can insulate myself, at least mentally, if not physically, I can still maintain a good, you know, mental health. Also keep in mind that the mind controls the body. It has been proven time and again that a lot of physical ailments are actually a consequence, or at least have been aggravated by the mind being disturbed. According to me, a very simple, what I would call as a Rancho definition of what is mental health, I would say, peace within yourself and harmony with others, significant others, your near and dear. Peace within myself. I am not perpetually confused. I don't go off into depression. I don't keep losing my temper. I am not, you know, finding it difficult to take some decisions as to what to do, how to move on, and things of that sort. If I've learned how to handle stress, yeah, there are times when I have to face difficult situations. I know how to manage it. That is what gives me peace within myself. But also remember that there are a lot of people who are at peace within themselves because they are making life miserable for others. There are families where the head of the family is such a tyrant. He says, I am doing everything for my family. I look after them. I earn for them. I love them and they love me. But you ask them and they will say that even his physical presence in the house makes us so uncomfortable. We are so happy when he is not around. Of course, he's our family member. We can throw him out or we can't run away from him. But we are very uncomfortable even when he is around because we don't know what next and in what way he is going to blow up or he is going to point out something or make us feel very unhappy. So peace within yourself is not enough. You should also be in harmony with your loved ones. You should be in harmony with people who are closest to you and whom you care for. If you do not do that, what happens? You will be hit by another pandemic. This pandemic, I have been cautioning, has been there for at least the last one decade and it is constantly growing. People don't take it seriously because it doesn't kill, but it definitely brings down your quality of life. And that is the pandemic of loneliness. When your mental health goes down, people start keeping away from you. And when people keep away from you, you start becoming more and more lonely and you start getting more irritable. You start pointing fingers at others. You're very unhappy with the others who are not treating you with love and care the way you wanted them to treat you. So it becomes a vicious cycle. The more I get angry with them, the more either I shout out or keep away from them, and I become more and more lonely. That is another indicator of your mental health. If you feel that you are a lonely soul, nobody cares for me, nobody makes friends with me, nobody is there for me when I need some emotional support, it means your mental health is not as good as it should have been. You have done something about it. Please don't pass the buck to the whole world. Everybody in this world wants to make friends with somebody or the other. Everybody wants to love someone or the other. Everybody likes nice, warm company, but they're keeping away from you because your mental health has gone down. Your behavior is such which is not acceptable to other people. And they say, why should we be nice to this person and this person is being so nasty to us? This is what I want you to understand. And this loneliness is going to continuously increase. The more we are into technology, the more we are into these COVID type of pandemics, the more we are going to be working from home and things like that, the greater will be the epidemic of loneliness, which is going to make a lot of lives very miserable. As I said, it doesn't kill. But you can live for the next 50 years a very, very, very lonely person. And there is, once you get caught in that trap, it's very difficult to come out. So preventive role, try to be around people, try to go out of the way and help somebody. Try to make friends with others, make gestures to reach out to people. These are the type of things that we need to know. The other thing to be able to keep good mental health is please use all parts of your brain. If you are a very logical or mathematical person, you are a software engineer or an accountant or something of that sort, you're using your left brain characteristics, which are mathematical, logical, things like that. Start doing activities which are what we call as right-brained, creative activities. Get into music. Start writing some blogs or talking to people in different ways. Start reading good literature and things like that. So regardless of what you are doing, what is your profession, please start using all parts of your brain. That is your vaccination against loneliness and against your mental health, you know, going down. Please understand that there is a very small role that mental health professionals can play in terms of the curative role. Preventive and preservative, all of us personally have to do. We don't even need professionals. Even if you go to them, they'll say that you're not suffering from any mental disorder. So what medication, what prescription can I give you? Just improve your quality of life and you'll be a happy person. And that's why I said that if we start taking these precautions from day one, today, whatever has been my life so far, now I will start improving on those things. As I told you, I will keep up a good sense of humor. I will keep up good relationships. I will look forward to the future. Man lives on hope. Even when you're going through the worst stress, worst of relationships, worst of whatever other hurdles and challenges that you are facing, if you keep your hope alive, that tomorrow I will do much better. We are coming to the halfway point, after which we will be taking in questions. So I thought, just to give an example of how good mental health develops from childhood and how people live on hope, I wanted to share with you a neighbor family who had two daughters. The elder one was what they call as a nerd. She had thick glasses and her nose would be perpetually stuck in her textbooks. And she used to get top marks and parents were very happy with her. The younger one, once in a while, used to think that there is something called studies or homework or tests. Pathetic, no marks she used to get. Parents are very worried. I won't forget the day I went out for an evening walk and this kid saw me from the window and, you know, started waving out to me, "Uncle, uncle, uncle, wait, 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 I want to talk to you." And she came running down the steps and came with a big grin on her face. "Uncle, I got my maths test results." Now I knew that maths is her most difficult subject. So I was getting ready to give her my condolence. I said, "Okay, you got maths test result. What happened?" "Uncle, I got 6 marks. 6 out of 20. 6 out of 20. "And what is the passing mark?" "8. 8 is the passing mark. Out of 20, you got only 6, and you're showing me all your 32 teeth and grinning away. What are you celebrating?" "No, uncle. Last time I got 4. No. This time I got 6. Maybe next time I'll get 8 also." That, ladies and gentlemen, is good mental health. So let's take a quick break and we'll be back to answer your questions.
So hi everyone. So those were some wonderful tips by Ali. In fact, from 3rd of October, we have been putting short and crisp videos on our social media, and all of them are now available on our YouTube channel. So we have a YouTube channel, you can subscribe to that. All our videos, you know, go into that. And I'll just, you know, brief you on a few happenings. You know, a few more things that are coming up next, you know, with all this. And I'm glad today is the World Mental Health Day. And we have all slowly started realizing the importance of mental health. So in Banjara, we have a lot of talks and webinars from time to time. And please keep a track of that through our website. So we keep putting up the upcoming events. And just to give you a brief on what's coming up next is managing difficult relationships. That's the next Saturday's topic, and that's a webinar. It's a paid webinar, so do get in touch with us for details. And again, our Helping Hand talk on Thursday. So you are welcome. As you know, you can come to our academy and take part. That is on ego in relationships. So these are the various topics that we keep, covering. But if you really want to, grow, a lot of self-growth and development, if you're looking for that, you can enroll for our one-year part-time program called Diploma in Counseling Skills. We have the last few seats available for this year. So if you are keen to take that up, you can call us in Banjara, and we'll be glad to give you all the details about the program. So already, three teams have started, and the fourth team, the classroom session, is starting on 15th of this month. So in fact, if you would like to come and attend the first class also, you're more than welcome. So do get in touch for any of these details. So many other programs coming up. Be in touch, and back to Dr. Ali.
Hi, once again. One or two quick tips. By the time, I hope we are going to get a lot of questions. Being with nature is one way of improving and maintaining your mental health. Nature teaches us delayed gratification. Nature teaches us that one can live in harmony with everyone in the whole universe. Nature teaches us that there's such a huge expanse of the world out there that I need not worry about what's happening inside my 2 BHK or 3 BHK, things of that sort. Nature teaches us that there is a past, there is a present, and there is a future which merge into each other all the time in good harmony. That is one thing that I want you to keep in mind. The other thing is, one very good way to maintain your own mental health is to help others maintain good mental health. You want to be a trained counselor, like Seema was just telling you, you can get trained. But even without that, the more you reach out to your friends, your neighbors, your relatives, whoever you can reach out to, you go to a shop to buy something, and the same shopkeeper is there and he's looking a little dull. You just ask him what happened. You always used to have a smile. Today I see you a little pulled down. My mother is not well and something, or I'm having some financial problems and all. You can't solve any of those. But he will feel nice that you as a customer could have just come, paid the money, bought things and gone away. But you took that attention. So he thinks that the world is a good place. There are nice people who care for me, who inquire about me. And most important, you feel nice. When at the end of the day, when you are recounting, reviewing how the day went, and when you are thinking of all these stresses and the uncomfortable things that are happening, these small, small things, when you have reached out to others, they play a very, very significant role. So with that, we move on to the questions. Nagashree says, can you kindly brief about insulating ourselves from insulating and short-tempered? And yes, mentally insulating yourself means not allowing yourself to get so badly affected. Now, you know that this person is short-tempered, or this person, puts you down, or whatever may be that behavior. Initially, yes, it will come as a shock, particularly if it's a close person who's trying to be nasty to you. So you try to overcome that, you try to bring about a change, you try to reason it out with him. But in many cases, what happens? You realize that no, this person is not going to change. There's no point in breaking your head trying perpetually to change him. The second thing is, can I get away from him? If he happened to be a friend or colleague or neighbor, I could have physically kept myself away from him, but if he's a family member, if he's somebody very close to me, physically I can't run away. So I will mentally prepare myself. When this person is coming into the room, or when I am entering into the room and I'm going to be sitting and talking to him, I should take a deep breath and tell myself, I know that this person may say something nasty or this person may shout. I'm not going to get affected by it. I am a good human being. I have good relationships with others. I am spreading harmony all around. Unfortunately, with this person, it is not working out. No issues. And the same thing when this person is doing something nasty, trying to provoke you. See, most of the time, these are the type of people who keep provoking you. And they expect you to respond in a negative way. If you don't do that, then they automatically start reducing their outbursts and you start feeling better. Now, the flip side of it, Rajiv Vijay has asked, if we isolate or insulate from people with mental issues or people who are negative, who will be there for them? I'm not saying you run away. That's what I meant. When this person acts nasty, when this person is shouting, I'm protecting myself from getting pulled down, from getting depressed or feeling miserable and feeling that life is not worth it, eventually leading to severe depression, suicidal feelings and all that. So I am protecting myself, right? Once the person learns, when somebody is good to me, I mean, when I'm good to somebody, the people respond. So the moment the day he is nice to you, he just makes one simple nice comment or he doesn't raise his voice, that's the day you reach out to him. Let him learn that carrot and stick policy, which we use with children so many times, we can use it with adults also in the same way. Over a period of time, nothing is going to happen overnight. It takes a long time. But since, as I said, the person is so close to you, it may be a lifelong relationship, you start practicing that. The day or the moment when he is nice to you, be extremely nice to him. When he is short-tempered or when he is putting you down or when he is cheating, you completely mentally insulate myself. How to cope with people with extreme mood swings, Bharti is asking. What is their state of mental health? Their state of mental health is not at all good. I don't know to what extent. That we will have to see individually. There may be somebody with great mood swings who is actually suffering from some sort of, you know, major mental disorder. There may be somebody who has just had bad experiences and is trying to take out his frustration on others. So we have to evaluate that person. But the fact remains, as I was just telling you, that if there is somebody with mood swings, whenever his mood is good, you spend a lot of time, you know, interacting with them. When the person's mood swings the other way and who goes into that state of anger or something of that sort, just try to be as, you know, insulated as possible. Don't run away. Don't make it a point to ignore or, you know, to glare at him or something. Pretend as though nothing has happened. Pretend as though you didn't hear all that shouting or that putting down or something. Where you have to interact, yeah, I'm having a cup of tea. Would you also be interested in sharing with me? That's it. Beyond that, make it clear to the person that when your mood is good, I'm very much there for you. When your mood is bad, I am not going to get affected by whatever behavior pattern you have, and I am not going to respond to you. Namneet says, how to cope with our own children who have low mental health? Namneet, as I was telling a few minutes back, you know, children very rarely have low mental health, but if they do, then they have obviously at a very early age been through some form of trauma, something which should not have happened at an innocent age. And I would take that up very seriously. So if you have a child whose mental health seems to be low, who's showing all these type of symptoms that I was talking about, please take it seriously. I would suggest that take that child to a child psychologist, a counselor, a therapist, whatever it is. You need not take the child to a psychiatrist in the beginning, because as far as possible, we avoid medication unless we realize that, yes, this person is suffering from a clinical issue. Let's see what they have to say. Let's see how they analyze and what is happening to the child. And then we can decide. Otherwise, just saying a child with low mental health is too general a thing for me to comment. Masu sir, surrounded by everything online, how to help kids to cope with this? Even though my kids want to play outside, their friends are all online, which becomes irresistible for kids. I agree. We are going through a very bad phase. But what we can do, to whatever extent we can, is to make the time away from the screen as interesting, as challenging, as exciting as we can. We have to create opportunities for the children. Time and again, I have been giving out lists of activities which a family can do when the children are locked in. I'm not going to repeat that over here, but if anybody wants a list of all possible activities that you can do as a family at home, which are not connected to any screen, I will send you the list. You just email us and I will send it to you. But it can be done. There are a lot of things which children will enjoy doing and which have got nothing to do with the screen. Those are the type of things that we need to do. Surekha says, how do we deal with close people who are argumentative, ego invested, and have abundant pester power? Yes. As I was mentioning to you, what is this pester power? They want to instigate you. They pester you, meaning to say, they will go on saying nasty things. They will pass sarcastic remarks. They will make loose statements about you in front of a third person, and they will look at you from the corner of their eye. They want you to react. They want you to either break down and start crying, and then they will say, see, I can't even carry out a conversation. This one just starts crying all the time. How do you deal with such people? So put the blame on you. If you react, if you argue back and say, who said I'm doing this, or you are not the one who's doing that or something, now they are game. They feel very thrilled that this person is rising up to the challenge. So I will have this ping pong battle. You throw the ball in my court, I throw the ball in your court. And that's why, as I said, what we need to do is to look the person straight in the eye, have a neutral expression, and respond only to that effect. Sometimes you can even say, oh, that's your opinion, is it? That's it. I'm not saying yes, I'm not saying no. That is your opinion, is it? And we move on. If there is something to be discussed about, you know, what would you like to have for dinner, or I'm going out for half an hour, or whatever it is, continue that communication. But minimize it so that you do not touch upon any topic which can lead to further arguments. Vikas says, how to read other person's mind, what is going on inside? For example, depression, not visible outside, but present inside. Yes, depression is one of the most common disorders of the mind. Various surveys have shown that maybe between 15 to 30% of all human beings at some time or the other go through severe depression. If it is not clinical depression, if it has not made the person totally dysfunctional and unable to do anything and all that, for which you have to go to a psychiatrist, there is no other way out. You have to put the person first on medication, and once the symptoms start coming back, then we deal with the other issues. But if it is not that bad, there are a lot of ways and means which time to time we have been discussing how to, you know, help a person to come out of the depressive phase. Again, it depends whether it's a reactive depression or an endogenous depression. A reactive depression is a depression which happens as a reaction to something. I have failed in my exam. I have lost my job. I have had a relationship breakup. So when I go into depression based on that, that means it is reactive. So we have to work on the issue that has happened. Even if it cannot be resolved physically, resolve it emotionally with the person to come to terms with whatever failure or breakup or whatever has happened, and then help the person move on. If it is endogenous, then the person may need medication or may need long-term therapy because his mind is malfunctioning. It's not a reaction to something else. All these things step by step we can take depending on the severity. If it is just a minor thing, family members, friends, caregivers, so many people can take care of those things. Sindhu says, how to avoid by not getting into negative thoughts? This is what, you know, techniques like CBT, cognitive behavior therapy, all these things, you know, teach us. And we propagate that for those who are interested in learning those techniques. A simple thing like CBT says that we have cognitive distortions. That means cognition is our mind, the way our thoughts take place, okay? So we have cognitive distortion. That means I believe in certain things which are not true, but I have psyched myself and I think that this is the only thing that is happening. For example, I may say things like, none of my relatives like me, they all put me down. Now, if I have 17 relatives, it is impossible that all 17 hate me or all 17 try to put me down. That is a cognitive distortion. So if I start correcting my thought process, rationalizing it, reworking on it, automatically my emotions improve and I feel much better about it. China says, good morning, I try to do good to everyone but end up with feeling sad because someone or the other will be unhappy. Is it because I'm weak in my mental health? No, China, not at all. The very fact that you are trying to do good to everybody shows that you have very good mental health. Only thing is, be a little selective. When you said, I try to do good to everyone, you can't do it. You have to be selective. There are people who will not respond and there are people who will respond in a negative manner. They'll make you feel even more sad. They'll pull you down. So be a little selective. You can't be a savior for the whole world. Those people are important to you. Those people who respond to you, do as much as you can for such people. Seema says, what if our own loved one makes us feel so pathetic and dejected that you lose all the confidence to face the outside world? Greatest of the thinkers, from Mahatma Gandhi downwards, so many have said, nobody can make you happy or sad. People can make life miserable for you. Pain, as great thinkers have said, pain is inevitable. Suffering is optional. The same way as it happens with physical pain, there are people who say that, yes, I'm having this severe migraine, but I will tolerate it. I know that it will go off. I'll shut myself in the room. I'll take some tablets. I'll do this or that or something of that sort, and then I'll get well. There are others who say, see, my life is so miserable. Every now and then I get a migraine. I have to suffer whenever I get a migraine. The whole day I'm out of this. That suffering you have created, remember that. Same thing happens when somebody else is trying to put you down or make you miserable. It is you who can choose. That's what I meant by saying insulating yourself. Vinita says, people are refusing to accept that they have some mental health issues, but it's clear or seen by others. How can we tell them it's challenging? Sometimes it's very challenging, Vinita, I understand that. Many people who suffer from mental disorders are in total denial. One is to see whether we can influence them by people whom they listen to. Maybe their parent, their best friend, their elders, their guru or somebody like that. So if we can reach out to them through somebody whom they have regard for, they will listen a little more. When we are counseling them, what do? We don't tell them that you are suffering from a mental disorder. We say that you are having to face negativity. This person says, none of my family members love me. But the reason for that is because he's been shouting at them. So I don't point out the shouting. I say that I feel bad that you work so hard, you go to office, when you come back home, you're looking forward to a nice, warm, loving, caring family, but then you have all this jig-jig going on and there are people who are not caring for you. I want you to improve your life. You deserve to improve your life. So what do we do about it? Are you open to bringing about some changes? I'll work with you. I will guide you. That's how we work with the rider, that not everybody is open to it. Some of them will say, no, I don't need to work on anything because I am not doing anything wrong. It is the others who have to do it. Sometimes we even go to that extent of saying that, yes, I will help the others who are the people who are undergoing all this, but I need your help. Can you come and sit with me and give me some inputs? That way, slowly we break ice. And we bring them around and then we help them if somewhere or the other with a lot of patience and understanding, if we can make them understand that they do need to work on it.
Ali, a question from Instagram.
Yeah.
Is mood variation considered disorder and mental illness?
To what extent? We all have mood variations. In a moment, I can be feeling happy. In a moment, I can be feeling sad. Nothing wrong with it. But if it is so much that I become unpredictable, nobody knows when I'm going to suddenly start snapping. Or I myself don't know when I will say something nasty to someone. So if the mood variation goes beyond a certain point, it goes to the extent of affecting my relationships, people start thinking negatively or keeping away from me, then yes, it is a disorder. I as a very simple layperson would say, any issue which can cause irreversible harm is an issue that should be looked upon as a mental health issue. If it is temporary, when I lost this job or when I had this problem, I was very nasty with my family members. They understood that I'm going through a bad phase, so they tolerated all my irritation and anger. Then I got a good job and I moved on. Fine, nothing happens. But as I said, if it goes to the point where I may have irreversible damage, I may spoil my relationship with my family members, I may lose my job, I may get into, you know, a bad reputation among my neighbors and friends, then yes, it is an issue. Kavya says, how to deal with friends who always seek attention. Firstly, you should feel for them because you said they are friends. They obviously are lonely people, as I was telling a few minutes back. Loneliness is a great epidemic that is spreading. They don't have the right type of emotional support or friends. They find that you are a warm-hearted person, you are a genuine person. So they are seeking your attention because there are such few people like you. So they are seeking your attention. The only point I would like to say is balance your own needs. Don't allow them to intrude on your privacy and your free time. If this person is calling you every day and wants to talk for 1 hour, do it for the first 1, 2, 3 days, and then after that slowly start telling, tomorrow I'm going to be very busy, I've got some very important work, I'll talk to you day after tomorrow. 2 days later when that person calls up, you say, oh, glad you called me at 5:30. Because 6 o'clock, I have to go for some important meeting. So we'll spend half an hour talking and then I will push off. Like that, you start reducing the quantity and the quality of the interactions. Just reassure that, yes, I care for you, I'm there for you. But of late, I've been a little busy with this. I will, whenever I get time, whenever it's possible, we will interact. I would like to listen to you. Keep giving that type of emotional support. Don't take responsibility for the salvation of that person. Don't feel that unless I give her attention, she will go into depression, then what will happen? No. You are a human being in your own right. You do whatever you can. Beyond that, don't feel responsible. Runalini says, how to deal with a friend who is giving away too much empathy to others all the time. If she is getting affected by doing things like that, if her quality of life is going down, if she is neglecting her near and dear, or if she is always complaining that, you know, I have to keep giving to everybody, nobody gives to me and all that, that is when you help her to slow down. Like I was just telling you just now, tell her that you're a very wonderful person, you're reaching out to so many people, you're doing such good, but don't allow them to walk all over you. Don't allow your own, you have your own life. You also deserve to be happy. You also deserve to spend time with your own loved ones or your own hobbies and this and that. Just help her to slowly start reducing this thing that she is doing. Anupma says, what can be a good indicator for poor mental health with people who have low sense of humor as part of their personality? That's what I said. No, people whose sense of humor goes down, they start taking themselves too seriously, they start getting irritated, they don't want to make light banter and this and that. They can't play around with children. Even if a child does something, this person suddenly gets very angry. Person keeps pointing out, you know, things, why did you keep your slippers there, why did you not do this or something of that sort. If those type of things happen, you know that the mental health is going on. That's the first step. Now, what caused it, as I told you, if it's temporary, he's threatened with a job loss, that's why nowadays he's like that, tolerate him. Maybe in a few days, a few weeks, things will settle down. If it is permanent, if it is becoming a habit, then you have to take the steps which I've already mentioned to you about insulating yourself, trying to make the person understand and things of that sort. Yes.
Ali, another question from Sufia on Instagram. Why do we feel like not even replying to any, if anyone questions us sometimes?
You have a right, Sufia. You don't have to reply every time that somebody questions you. Don't feel compelled. If you feel that this is the type of question which you don't have to reply or it can lead to some arguments or something of that sort. One of the simplest ways I have found is when the person says, why are you doing this or why can't you do this for me or something like that. Oh yeah, I know. That's a very important question. Let me think over it and reply to you. Most people who are impulsive and trying to provoke you, you know, when you ask for time, they themselves forget what they had said, and you can get away with the thing. How to be okay when having lots of problems in relationship life, having lots of misunderstandings that's going on increasing. Yes, Asta, I want you to understand that if things are increasing like that, please take the precautions. Please do the preventive role. When you know that things are increasing, one fine day the water will be above your head. Don't wait for that. You know that the water is rising. Start taking steps. What you can do by yourself, do it. What you cannot do by yourself, take the help of your loved ones. What you cannot do even with your loved ones, start off with seeking outside help. Surekha says, how do we build an emotional wall against disturbing people? I told you, no. When this person is going to come around, when you're going to interact with that person, take a deep breath, slow down yourself, do whatever stress relief activities, recite some mantra or some positive affirmations. Then when you start off with, you know, interacting with the person and you find that the person is being very abusive, some simple thing like, oh, I see, let me think over it. Or right now I'm a little busy, I will get back on to you. So like that, there are simple ways and means. You have to start practicing it. As I told each one of you, if you want some tips on certain specific things, like Nehal is asking how to work on increased anxiety levels. So if you write to me, maybe I'll give you a page of tips on how to deal with anxiety. So specifically when a person feels that I have issues which are related to anxiety, I always get worried about the future and I start thinking what will happen, something will go bad and things of that sort. That is what we call as anxiety, no? Worrying about things which have not happened. So how do I deal with it? There are ways and means of doing it. Shaila says, thanks for taking DCS course. I could handle this pandemic situation happily. Could handle mother-in-law when she lost her best friend, husband lost his friend due to corona, and a friend whose wife is on ventilator for the past 2 weeks. Very sorry to hear that. He's slowly talking and able to handle the situation. Thanks to Banjara. Thank you very much for acknowledging that. We are doing whatever level best we can do. It's a drop in the ocean, like Mother Teresa said. But if each one of us keeps adding that, drop into the ocean, we can all contribute in whatever way. These are just the tip of the iceberg, whatever the question that you have raised, whatever responses I could give you. But there will be many more. I can see that questions are still coming in. But these are great sticklers for time. When we say that this webinar is 11 to 12, we mean that it is 11 to 12. We want to respect the time of others. So those who would have wanted to, you know, have some other commitments after 12 o'clock, we will respect that. But I close with that one point, that is that we are always there for you. This seminar is only an icebreaker for you to think later. And how and what and everything, in just half a minute, if you have patience, Seema will wind up and tell you how we can take things further to create a better life for ourselves and for people around us. Thank you and have a wonderful week.
That was a wonderful eye-opening session, wasn't it? So I hope all of us spread the word about losing the stigma for mental health and help others also to lose the stigma. And thank you everyone for joining us today and in this all-important mission about mental health. Have a wonderful weekend, both physically as well as mentally. Until next time, goodbye.